The Philippine government says 17 out of the 26 remaining Filipinos in Gaza are now scheduled to cross into Egypt in the coming days. The Marcos administration also vowed to double down on efforts to ensure the Filipinos' safety amid the spiraling conflict.
Patuloy naman ang aming ginagawa upang ang ating mga kababayan ay maging maganda naman ang kanilang sitwasyon at sa lalong madaling panahon ay sana makauwi na sila.
Meanwhile, freed Filipino hostages Noraline Babadilla and Jimmy Pacheco set to return to Manila. The two are now awaiting advice from the Israeli embassy regarding the date of their return. Israel has resumed its military operations in Gaza after its week-long ceasefire with Hamas expired Friday. Nearly 200 people have been killed. As this report tells us, the U.S. is pinning the blame on Hamas for the end of the truce.
Scenes of devastation in Rafah refugee camp as Israel resumes its bombardment following the end of the week-long truce, and in Khan Yunis, also in southern Gaza. Meanwhile, rockets were fired from northern Gaza toward Israel. The two sides blamed each other. Speaking from Dubai, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken joined Israel in blaming Hamas.
Hamas reneged on commitments it made. In fact, even before the pause came to an end, it committed an atrocious terrorist attack in Jerusalem, killing three people, wounding others, including Americans. It began firing rockets before the pause had ended, and as I said, it reneged on the commitments it made in terms of releasing certain hostages.
The truce ended early Friday as Blinken left Israel. Hamas accused him of giving Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu permission to resume strikes.
It was clear yesterday that the Israeli side wants to go back to fighting, as several ideas were put forward by mediators, and we accepted three of them. And despite that, the Israeli side said no, 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 every time.
With more than 100 hostages still held by Hamas, another truce could restart if both parties agree. Blinken said the U.S. is pushing for it. He again urged Israel to avoid further mass displacement of Palestinians and damage to critical infrastructure, and to begin discussion about what happens to Gaza once the fighting ends.
How's it governed? Where does the security come from? How do we begin to rebuild? And, critically, how we get on a path to a just and lasting peace. And for us, of course, that has to result in a state for the Palestinians.
Earlier this week in Ramallah, West Bank, Blinken told Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas that the U.S. is set to impose visa bans on Israeli settlers who attack Palestinians in the West Bank, signaling a tougher stance from the Biden administration as international pressure mounts on Israel.
It's around 1,000 children have had an upper or lower limb, or both, amputated these past weeks, around 1,000. Again, it's callous to think that we are now, to know that we are now apparently returning to that.
The UN is urging Israel to abide by international humanitarian law and ensure the protection of civilians. The Israeli military says it has taken steps to do so. Patsy Widakuswara, VOA News, Washington.
The entry of humanitarian aid into Gaza becoming more uncertain after the lapse of the week-old truce. This is according to the United Nations, which warned the already catastrophic situation in the Strip might worsen if much-needed aid will not be delivered immediately. Israeli forces had reportedly stopped all entry of aid and fuel trucks into Gaza after Israel resumed its military campaign Friday.
Any continuation in the uptick of delivery of basic supplies into and across Gaza is now, of course, uncertain because of the resumed hostilities, which obviously makes the distribution of humanitarian goods that much more difficult. Secretary General said he regretted the resumption of hostilities in Gaza and Israel. He urges all concerned parties to swiftly find a way to resume the pause in the fighting and facilitate the release of more hostages. We appeal to the parties not to resort to further military action that can only make the already catastrophic humanitarian situation in Gaza worse and to spare civilians from more suffering.
The Filipino seafarers who sustained injuries after a missile hit their ship in the Black Sea are appealing for help upon their arrival in the Philippines. Karen de Guzman reports.
The Filipino captain and the other 13 crew members who were traumatized after a Russian missile damaged their ship in the Black Sea have returned to the Philippines on Saturday. Some of them suffered minor injuries, including Arnel Lopez, the ship captain who was near the Ukrainian pilot killed in the missile attack.
Dinidikit nga po kami sa Puerto. Yung piloto po, inasisan ako. So, yun po. Tapos biglang sumapo na namatay po.
Nagtamo po ba kayo ng sugat?
Eh, nung po una sa mukha po, sa mukha po ng mga nabasag ng bubong. Tapos medyo masakit po yung likod ko. Tapos medyo nabingi po.
After witnessing the missile hit their vessel, crew member Second Officer Giovanni Perez is still reeling from the tragedy.
Medyo malapit po ako sa anong pangyayari. Madalas, napapanaginipan po yung... Iba-iba po yung panaginip, pero pare-parehas na may missile na tumatama sa batyo namin.
He also has this appeal to authorities.
Tawagan na lang po namin na makahingi kami ng kunting tulong po sa inyo. Kasi po kami ay, yung marami po sa amin is under contract pa po. And then, yung mga papasok pa po ng mga seafarer na Filipino, as much as possible, kung pwede din pong paiwasan na bumiyahe sa ganitong war zone area.
The seafarers were welcomed by the Department of Migrant Workers and the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration, and they have initially gave them financial assistance. Karen De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
The U.S. State Department approves the potential sale of training devices to Australia for an estimated $2 billion. This is part of Washington's AUKUS security agreement with Australia and the U.K. This deal allows the sale of U.S. nuclear-powered submarines and sharing of nuclear propulsion technology with Australia, as well as a joint development of high-tech weaponry. The three-way pact is the biggest defense project in Australian history, which has been criticized by China as having the potential to start an arms race. Top military officials of the Philippines, the U.S., Japan, and Australia conclude high-level talks in Tokyo. The first joint service staff talks discussed opportunities to expand cooperation and uphold a rules-based international order. It also reaffirmed the commitment of the four allies to a free and open Indo-Pacific. This meeting is an offshoot of the Defense Ministerial Summit of the four countries held in Singapore in June. The Philippine Coast Guard inaugurates its new West Philippine Sea Station on Pagasa Island. The upgraded station offers improved living conditions for its personnel. It's also seen as a boost to the Coast Guard's capability to monitor maritime incursions and sea mishaps. National Security Advisor Eduardo Año says the Pagasa Coast Guard Station will help address what he calls China's aggressive and unruly bullying of Filipino fisherfolk and sailors.
Ang behavior kasi ng itong Chinese Coast Guard, PLA Navy, Chinese militias are sometimes unpredictable. They do not adhere to the international order, sa rule of law. Kaya yung sinasabi nyo na gray zone tactics, actually hindi na yung gray zone. It's pure bullying and it's pure illegal. So hindi na yung tinatawag na gray zone. And it's not acceptable in the international order.
Over now to the ongoing climate talks in Dubai. Controversy plagues the high-stake COP28 summit. A member of the main advisory board of the COP28 summit resigned on Friday over reports the UAE presidency planned to use the meeting to secure oil and gas deals. Hilda Hine, former president of climate-vulnerable Marshall Islands, said these actions threatened to undermine the credibility of the COP process. She added, the only way the COP presidency can restore trust was to deliver an outcome that demonstrates its commitment to phasing out fossil fuels. But COP President Sultan Al-Jaber denied the report, published by the Center for Climate Reporting and the BBC. The historic launch of a long-awaited climate disaster fund gives the COP28 summit a running start. The so-called Loss and Damage Fund aims to help countries, especially the vulnerable ones, withstand the impact of climate change. The summit's host, the United Arab Emirates, committed $100 million, while the European Union pledged $246 million. The U.S., Britain, and Japan also gave their share to the fund. Philippine Representative Environment Chief Tony Yulo Loizaga lauded the breakthrough.
It's a very encouraging sign that developed countries are beginning to recognize what we are calling the common but differentiated responsibility and respective capacities. And we want to be at the forefront of that. So the President, as you know, as you heard, has announced that the Philippines will pursue the hosting of the Loss and Damage Fund Board. And we hope to be able to also have a seat on that board.
Countries are racing to achieve a clean energy future and make deeper cuts to emissions as the world remains off track to keep global temperatures below agreed levels. Britain's King Charles warns the global economy could suffer unless the environment was rapidly repaired. During his opening address to the COP28 summit, the monarch said the world is dreadfully far off track in addressing climate change.
Unless we rapidly repair and restore nature's unique economy based on harmony and balance, which is our ultimate sustainer, our own economy and survivability will be imperiled. I pray with all my heart that COP28 will be another critical turning point towards genuine transformational action at a time when already, as scientists have been warning for so long, we are seeing alarming tipping points being reached.
Antonio Guterres echoing Charles's urgency as he warns the world is dangerously close to missing the 1.5 degree limit set by the Paris Agreement in 2015.
We are miles from the goals of the Paris Agreement and minutes to midnight for the 1.5 degree limit. But it is not too late. We can, you can prevent planetary crash and burn. We have the technologies to avoid the worst of climate chaos if we act now. So allow me to have a message for fossil fuel company leaders. Your old role is rapidly aging. Do not double down on an obsolete business model. Lead the transition to renewables using the resources you have available. Make no mistake, the road to climate sustainability is also the only viable pathway to economic sustainability of your companies in the future. And I urge governments to help industry make the right choice by regulating, legislating, putting a fair price on carbon, ending fossil fuel subsidies, and adopting a windfall tax on profits.
Overseas, five Republican senators urging U.S. President Joe Biden to impose a travel ban to and from China. This amid a spike in Chinese respiratory illness cases. According to Senator Marco Rubio, this should be implemented until the country can learn more about the dangers posed by the illness. The rise in cases became a global issue when the World Health Organization cited a report on clusters of undiagnosed pneumonia in children in China. The WHO says the increase appeared to be driven by pathogens the children had avoided during the height of COVID-19 restrictions. U.S. Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell douses hopes of early interest rate cuts, saying discussions for that are premature. The U.S. Central Bank head made that remark during an event at Spelman College in Atlanta. Powell said they're committed to keeping policy restrictive until they're confident that inflation is cooling down to the Fed's target of 2%. U.S. inflation averaged 2.5% over the 6 months ending in October. Speculations that the Fed is putting an end to its rate hiking cycle have helped the U.S. markets rally, with the Dow Jones Industrial Average reaching a new high in 2023. Republican George Santos's brief career in the U.S. Congress comes to an end. In a landslide vote Friday, lawmakers expelled Santos from the House of Representatives. His tenure was marked by multiple lies about his past and allegations of fraud. But the final blow came last month when a House probe found Santos illegally spent his campaign money on Botox treatments, credit card debt, and even a pornography platform. The New York Republican is the sixth lawmaker in history to be expelled from the lower chamber. His expulsion also triggers an election in New York that threatens to further weaken Republicans' already shaky control of the U.S. House.